Something running around in there. So many reasons to rejoice. God dwells in the presence of his people. As I'd say, wherever two or more are gathered together, he is there. This is a great verse from Isaiah chapter 27. You will keep him in perfect peace whose mind is stayed on you, because he trusts in you. Trust in the Lord forever, for in God the Lord we have an everlasting rock. How gracious is our God. Peaceful rises, we wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. Peaceful rises, we wait upon the Lord. As we wait upon the Lord, we will wait upon the Lord. Our God, you reign forever. Sometimes that waiting is the hardest part, isn't it? Saying, okay, Lord, in your time, not mine. Although, God, I have a schedule, so please ignore it. How do you start your day? I hope it's in prayer and in God's word. In the morning when I rise, in the morning when I rise, in the morning when I rise, give me Jesus. Give me Jesus. Give me Jesus. You can have all this world, but give me Jesus. And when I am alone, and when I am alone, and when I am alone, give me Jesus. Give me Jesus. Give me Jesus. You can have all this world. Give me Jesus. And when I come to die, oh, and when I come to die, and when I If you've ever heard Fernando Ortega sing that song, if you haven't, YouTube it. Oh my goodness. He means it too when he says that. All that the world has to offer, it can be taken away in a heartbeat. It can be gone so fast because it's not eternal. But that which is eternal is where we should fix our eyes. That which is eternal is who we should hold to because he is forever trustworthy. The older I get, the more that becomes a reality. Because you see how things just slip through our hands, things that we've depended on, things that we've been confident, people that we've loved, that God has called home. Maybe we've based our relationships, has been the center of our lives. But the relationship that is eternal is that which is established with our Heavenly Father through His Son, Jesus Christ. That cannot be taken away from you. So fix your eyes, our hearts, our goals, your desires on that which cannot be taken. There's a peace I've come to know. Though my heart and flesh may fade, there's an anchor for my soul. I can say it is well. Jesus has overcome, and the grave is overwhelmed. Risen from the dead.
no more sorrow, no more pain. I will rise on eagle's wings before my God, fall on my knees and rise. I will rise. I will rise.
If you read history, you will find that the Christians who did the most for the present world were precisely those who thought the most of the next. So, oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Because he first loved me. Once again, oh, how I love Jesus. 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 Because he first loved me.
Father God, we praise you for the kindness that you showed us. In the love of Christ, Father, may it fill our hearts to overflowing, O Lord, our love for you and the love that you show in us and through us, O gracious God. May we be patient with ourselves and patient with others, O Lord, and love them the way that you love. So, Father God, may the truth of the gospel be on our lips and our hearts and on our minds, and the hope that is ours because we are yours, fill us in every day to strengthen us, to help us to have resolve and to keep our eyes fixed on you. So Lord, bless your word today as it's shared. Bless my brothers and sisters here gathered today and those watching, Father, from afar. And we just want to say we love you and we thank you, Almighty God, our gracious Savior. How kind you are. We praise you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, Pancho and Steve. And Steve and Nancy, welcome back. Good to have you back with us. Good morning, everyone. Please take your Bible and turn to Revelation chapter 21. We're going to be in Revelation chapter 21 again today. I'm going to read a little farther and a little more in depth, but we're still in this kind of in the survey mode. We live in trying times, don't we? A lot of uncertainty in the world. There is not uncertainty, but certainty with the Lord and with his word and his promises and his plan. Nothing that's going on in this world, including and especially in the life of you, the believer, follower of Jesus, that's not out of control, or that's just so that there's nothing that's out of control, and that nothing is surprising. You know that how many people say OMG on Facebook? God's never typed that. You never said it either. Right? Out of surprise or anger or disgust. Is he nothing surprises him. He has a plan, and his plan for you is perfect. Now mine, on the other hand, sometimes I I'm just kidding. It's we do have a tendency to want to give the Lord some advice, don't we? Yeah. So today, what will heaven be like? Continued. I'm going to read this chapter for you. The scripture, we're going to go all the way through Revelation 22:5. And consider the whole chapter, Lord willing. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth. For the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and there was no more sea. I, John, saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from heaven saying, look, behold, the tabernacle of God is with men, and he will dwell with them. They shall be his people, and God himself will be with them and be their God. God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes, and there shall be no more death. Neither shall there be any more sorrow, nor crying, nor pain, for the former things have passed away. He who was seated on the throne said, behold, I am making all things new. Then he said to me, write, for these words are faithful and true. He said to me, it is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. I will give of the spring of the water of life to him who thirsts. He who overcomes shall inherit all things, and I will be his God, and he shall be my son. But the cowardly, the unbelieving, the abominable, the murderers, the sexually immoral, the sorcerers, the idolaters, and all liars shall have their portion in the lake which burns with fire and brimstone. This is the second death. One of the seven angels, who had the seven bowls full of the seven last plagues, came to me and said to me, come, I will show you the bride, the wife of the Lamb. And he carried me away in the spirit to a great and high mountain and showed me the holy city, Jerusalem, descending out of heaven from God, having the glory of God. Her light, like a most precious jewel, like a jasper, clear as crystal. It had a great high wall with 12 gates, and at the gates 12 angels, and on the gates the names of the 12 tribes of the sons of Israel were written. Three gates on the east, three gates on the north, three gates on the south, three gates on the west. The wall of the city had 12 foundations, and on them were the names of the 12 apostles of the Lamb. He who talked with me had a golden rod to measure the city and its gates and wall. The city lies as a square, its length as long as its width. He measured the city with the rod, 1,400 miles. Its length and breadth and height are equal. He then measured its wall 200 feet by the measurement of a man, that is, of an angel. The wall was built of jasper, and the city was pure gold, as clear as glass. The foundations of the wall of the city were garnished with all kinds of precious jewels. The first foundation was jasper, the second sapphire, the third chalcedony, the fourth emerald, the fifth sardonyx, the sixth sardius, the seventh chrysolite, the eighth beryl, the ninth topaz, the tenth chrysoprase, the 11th jacinth, and the 12th amethyst. The 12 gates were 12 pearls, and each of the gates made of a single pearl. And the street of the city was pure gold, transparent as glass. I saw no temple in the city, for the Lord God Almighty and the Lamb are its temple. The city has no need of sun or moon to shine in it, for the glory of God is its light, and its lamp is the Lamb. And the nations of those who are saved shall walk in its light, and the kings of the earth shall bring their glory and honor into it. And its gates shall never be shut by day, and there shall be no night there, and they shall bring into it the glory and honor of the nations. No unclean thing shall ever enter into it, nor shall anyone who commits abomination or falsehood, but only those whose names are written in the Lamb's book of life. Then he showed me a pure river of the water of life, clear as crystal, flowing from the throne of God and of the Lamb in the middle of its street. Each side of the river was the tree of life. Each bore 12 kinds of fruit, yielding its fruit each month. The leaves of the tree were for the healing of the nations, and there shall be no more curse. The throne of God and of the Lamb shall be in it, and his servants shall serve him. And they shall see his face, and his name shall be on their foreheads. Night shall be no more. They need no lamp, nor the light of the sun, for the Lord God will give them light, and they shall reign forever and ever. Amen. Amen. So be the Lord. Lord bless us with your word, Father. So we're talking about that Jesus is coming. Go ahead. And it was called eschatology, the study of last things. Let's look at the quote from Corrie Ten Boom. I'll read it for you. Again, you're welcome to the slides. Just let me know afterwards, maybe on a card or something, or email. In China, the Christians were told, don't worry before the tribulation comes. You will be translated, raptured, Then came a terrible persecution. Millions of Christians were tortured to death. Later, I heard a bishop from China sadly say, "We have failed. We should have made the people strong for persecution rather than telling them Jesus would come first. Tell the people how to be strong in times of persecution, how to stand when the tribulation comes, to stand and not faint." We're not talking necessarily about the great tribulation, but Christians everywhere face trouble. And Christians today worldwide are facing trouble. So no matter what our eschatology is, we need to be prepared for trouble. Remember what I've taught you about my tribulation stance, right? Pro-trib, which means if Jesus is a trouble, I'm for it. I'm not looking for trouble. I sure don't want to be in the midst of the trouble. I don't want it to come to me. But I know that my Lord is in control of all things. Amen. He alone is King of kings and Lord of lords. Amen? Amen? Is that the God that you serve? We want to make sure that we know that we know that we know. Next, we talked last week about the one world leader, the one world government, the one world currency, the one world economy, the one world religion, and I shared a term with you that some hadn't heard of or many hadn't heard of. It's called the Great Reset. I hope you looked that up. There's a lot to it, and it's a lot closer to being enacted than I realized. And we talked about 2 Peter next. Go ahead and advance the slide. But what the judgment day is coming. God is going to destroy the heavens and the earth as they exist now. God's new heaven and new earth are coming. And how should we then live? That's chapter 3 of 2 Peter. And with I skipped the one about the things that we know for sure, didn't I? That Jesus is coming, we don't know when, and we need to be ready. And the other thing that we know for certain from Revelation 17:14 is that Jesus will overcome the evildoers and those who are with him. Those who are the called, the chosen, and the faithful. Advance it on down all the way to the five dimensions. Next, there we go. Remember this right here. If you don't remember anything else I say today, if you're a witness for Jesus, is if we don't get the gospel right, if we don't understand it ourselves, if we don't transmit, if we don't get the gospel right, all of our Christianity is wrong. And that's largely what's wrong in the United States Christianity today. Is when I was a kid, I think I heard the gospel right, and I responded. When you're a little kid, sometimes you don't really know exactly or remember what was said that night. But I'm here to tell you that many churches today, many Bible teachers are half-stepping the gospel. Oh, you're such lovely people. They come out with a microphone and say, "You're awesome." You're not awesome. You're a sinner who needs Jesus. Somebody say amen, right? Okay, all right. It's me too, me especially, because I know my heart. I know my heart. Steve was leading these songs, and I was overwhelmed a couple of times because, Lord Jesus, I can't do this. I can't even take care of myself. I can't even change myself. How am I going to change my wife or my kids or my congregation? So when we talk about the five dimensions or the aspects, remember, those are the five dimensions of the glorious gospel that Jesus, the Son of God, came to this earth. God the Son came to this earth in the form of a human man, the ultimate God-man. He lived a sinless life. He went to the cross, of his volition, and they murdered him. They executed him. And the Heavenly Father turned his back on the Son. And this God the Son died alone, mocked the whole planet against him. And he cried out, my God, why have you forsaken?" I can't even conceive of the infinite God-man who had loved his Father infinitely for all of eternity to have to suffer that for me. For me. And folks, there's five ways we need to understand it, that it happened on that cross in Calvary. This is not a geschichte. It's not a myth. It happened in history. It didn't happen in some. Nobody made this up. The disciples didn't make this up. Jesus was really put in that tomb, dead, 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 and he came out of it 3 days later, alive, alive, alive. Jesus, while he was hanging on that cross, he achieved certain things: our redemption, forgiveness. He paid for sins. He forgave the forgiveness of sins. He defeated sin, Satan, death, hell, and then the third aspect of it is he transfers those achievements to his people, to us, those who believe on his name. And because we believe on his name, we have this new identity, this new status, that we are now a child of God. Everybody on the planet is not a child of God. A lot of people that go to church on Sunday are not children of God. But oh, you are children. Make sure we belong to Jesus. And as we are children of God, he brings us together as his elect, his ecclesia, his church. And there should be and is in any group of believers as we assemble in the name of Jesus that there is something more than just a bunch of people here. The Lord himself is present. We just sang the song, didn't we? That that God is present among his people. And then, it's Jesus, my all-satisfying treasure. Because if Jesus has to compete for other stuff, I need to go back to this one. Because this is the one where so many people fall through a hole in the middle of the bridge that leads to glory. Right here is, I'm going to go to heaven just so my tail feathers don't get singed. No, I want to go be with Jesus. It's because he's there. You sang about that. Are these all true for me? And can you transmit these kind of things to your children, your grandchildren, your friends, your relatives, the lady at the cashier place, the lady down the street, anybody? Can you transmit them to somebody else? Next. Now we begin Revelation chapter 21. Next is, here's a summary of the first few verses about the new heaven and the new earth, the new Jerusalem, the God's dwelling there, no more tears, death, sorrow, or pain. I'm going to read to you. We're going to look right at the same scripture. Go ahead. We look at a couple of pictures. That's about the 1,400 miles. You hear some translations say 1,400 miles, 1,500 miles. If you do the math, if it goes by stadia, which is 600 feet per stadia or stadion, then it's 1,363 miles point something. But it's big. The New Jerusalem will be big. The New Jerusalem is real. The old, where we are now, all going to burn. The new heavens, the new earth, the New Jerusalem coming down from heaven out of earth. I take that to mean that it's going to happen literally, that is not symbolic. That God is going to do something that is going to make our eyes bug out, even in glorified bodies. And that's where and there's the little thing I showed you before about if it were to come down and be on the United States, which it ain't going to be on the United States. Remember that. Everybody say it with me. The United States is not represented in the book of Revelation. The United States is not recommended in the book of Revelation. That should help us with a lot of humility. I love the stars and stripes. I'm grateful for having been born in the United States of America. But folks, that flag's going to burn. Constitution is going to burn. All that stuff's going to burn. And it might burn too early for my taste. Next. Here we go. You can be looking up here with reading along with me, or you can read it in your Bible. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, and the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and there was no more sea. I, John, saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. Some people will confuse the New Jerusalem, and they'll say, well, that's the bride. No, the church is the bride. But what the Lord does is he identifies that New Jerusalem and its citizens as his bride. The place, the people, the everything. And that's where you and I would say, when we're watching the TV movies, you know, whoa, lots of angels and all that kind of stuff, and there's smoke, you know, the smoke machines and all that kind of stuff, that they're somewhere inside the New Jerusalem, because there's no clouds to walk around and twang on a harp and none of that. There'll probably be harps in heaven. I hope you're playing them, not me. The Bible doesn't say that's what we're going to be doing, so relax. You don't have to be a musician to go to heaven, although it might help, because you glorify God with your hands and your mouth, right? Okay, verse 3, and I heard a loud voice from heaven saying, behold, or look, the tabernacle of God is with men. That should help us to remember Emmanuel, that's that word that we all throw around at Christmas time. God is with us. And then in John chapter 1, verse 14, and the word became flesh and dwelt, tabernacled among us. And God is with men. And now we're really going to be with him. It's not going to be Jesus coming to see us. We're going to see Jesus. And he will dwell with them. He will abide with them. And they shall be his people. And God himself will be their God. We talked about the Shekinah. Verse 4. God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes. There will be no more death. Neither shall there be any more sorrow, nor crying, nor pain. For the former things have passed away. Listen to me. No death, no pain, no sorrow, no overdue bills, no cancer, no stumped toes, no indigestion, irritable bowel syndrome, no diabetes. I can just go around the room here. No walkers, no walkers, no crutches, none of that. No wheelchairs, no broken bones, none of that, none of that. It's going to be wonderful. No more sorrow. Anybody here been sorrowful today? This week, some of you, you're carrying burdens that and when Jesus gives you something to carry, that's not what I should be trying to get off of you, or friends should be trying to get off of us. But when we're carrying our own burdens that he doesn't want us to carry, we can get rid of those now. And if you need to talk to somebody, you have Steve and me. Look around. Get it off your chest. If you need somebody with skin on, talk to us. But the main best person to talk to is Jesus. Amen? Amen. Alone, on our face, but then face to face. We're going to be face to face. Verse 5. He who was seated on the throne, and remember we talked before about last week we talked about, we're not sure that we'll actually see the face of God the Father. But we don't know. We may. But we know that we're going to see the face of Jesus. He who was seated on... I'll tell you, there's more on that in other sermons. He who was seated on the throne said... Because it says... We can see there's sometimes it's the God and the Lamb. And then it says just the one. He who was seated on the throne said, behold, or look, I am making all things new. That is, everything is a new creation. If any man be in Christ, he is a... new creation. Old things have passed away. Behold, all things become new. From Corinthians. Then he said to me, write, for these words are faithful and true. And here's what he's going to write. Next. The Alpha and the Omega. Talk about those who thirst, the overcomer's inheritance, and those who don't, and then the second death. Look on to verse 6. Here we go. He said to me, it is done. Does that sound familiar? John chapter 19, I think it's verse 31. It is finished. It's also in Psalm 22:31. In Hebrew, in the English, it usually says, the Lord has performed this. But it's the equivalent of the Greek term tetelestai, which means it is finished, it is paid in full. He said to me, it is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega. Now, who has said that before? Earlier in Revelation, Jesus said, right? The beginning and the end. That's why Alpha and Omega. Alpha is the first letter of the Greek alphabet. Omega is the last letter of the Greek alphabet. In Hebrew, it would be Aleph and Tav. In English, it would be A to Z. And geographically, it would be Boston to Miami or whatever, or Maine to San Diego or whatever. Dan to Beersheba, sometimes it says in the Bible. I will give of the spring of the water of life to him who thirsts. Now, this isn't that it's going to happen in heaven. This is so we can get there. Jesus says, I am the living water. Those that he says, out of our belly shall flow rivers of living water. That we're to share Jesus, the love of Jesus, the sharing of Jesus, the ambassadors for Christ. Verse 7. He who overcomes shall inherit all things, and I will be his God, and he shall be my son. And we can put in there also our daughter, the son being the generic, be my child. Turn back to 1 John. It's about 15 pages before Revelation 1. No, it's not that far. three or four pages. First John chapter 5, verses 4 and 5. I want to read this to you so that puts you at ease, because when we see the word, those who overcome sounds like exertion from us, right? And we are supposed to exert ourselves. But listen to this. Listen to this very carefully. I would pick it up in verse 3. For this is the love of God, that we keep His commandments, and His commandments are not burdensome. That is, we are to keep the commandments even here on planet Earth. But now listen, because everybody's failed in that, right? Anybody lied before? Since you prayed the sinner's prayer? Yeah, absolutely, right? Most of us have fractured all 10 of them in one way or another. Maybe you haven't murdered anybody, but you've done character assassination, which is a lesser included offense. All of us are guilty. Verse 4, listen to this. For whoever is born of God overcomes the world. Get that? Overcomes the world. And the victory that overcomes the world is our faith. You with me? Faith and faith alone. Quit trying to work your way into a position where you think you please Jesus. You're not going to get there. You're most pleasing to Him when you just stop and say, Jesus, I can't do it. I can't do it anymore. I can't do this. I'm a failure. I'm a loser. I keep sinning the same old sin again and again. Now, it doesn't mean you're supposed to relax and go ahead and start sinning that sin and be comfortable. No, you're still going to fight that sin till your death. You're going to cry out to God to give you victory over. But remember, it's the faith that He gives you that enables you to believe on Him. That's what overcomes the world. That's why Jesus is the one who overcomes. Verse 5, who is it that overcomes the world but the one that believes that Jesus is the Son of God? It's a rhetorical question from John. It says, that's all there is and there ain't no more. Only those who believe on Christ for their salvation. And nobody else. That's what Jesus says too, right? No one comes to the Father but through Him. Okay. So he who overcomes shall inherit all things. That word inherit. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Who are the meek? Those who follow Jesus, who trust in Jesus, and who are doing their absolutest to yield to Him and obey Him. They're meek. They're meek toward God. And they will inherit the earth. And those evildoers who run the earth now say, yeah, they will, but when we're done with it. Well, they're going to be done with it one of these days pretty soon. And the meek, that is the followers of Jesus, are going to inherit the earth, that is the new earth. Because this earth ain't going to be worth it, right? After they're done fracking and all that kind of stuff. Verse 8. But the cowardly, the unbelieving. Now, see if you're in here anywhere. Cowardly, that's pretty much all of us right there, right? But the cowardly, the unbelieving, the abominable, the murderers, the sexually immoral, the sorcerers, the idolaters, and all liars shall have their portion in the lake which burns with fire and brimstone. This is the second death. That is, If you're any of these right here you might identify with, remember, don't identify with your old sins. You identify with Jesus. Somebody that does AA, a lot of times they stand up and say, hi, my name's Jack and I'm an alcoholic, is mistake number one. Or I should say, that's a good confession, but if we're not careful to move out of it, is what? Is I'm identifying with my sin. My sin becomes my identity. No, my name is Jack Rickman and I belong to Jesus Christ. He has paid for my sins. Whether it's any of these right here or any of your other, choose your own favorite sin, the besetting sins that you might have to deal with. When it says the second death, it says in Revelation chapter 20, verses 14 and 15 is the lake of fire. We'll talk about that another time. Ready? Next one, New Jerusalem and the bride, the angel's invitation, the mountain. New Jerusalem descends, and the New Jerusalem is described. And we'll go through this fairly quickly. One of the seven angels who had the seven bowls, in verse 9, one of the seven angels who had the seven bowls full of the seven last plagues, that is, this guy, this angel, is a bad dude in the sense that he is very powerful, and he has distributed the wrath of God liberally throughout the whole world. He is not a backbencher. He's not a private. He's more like a He's special forces angel kind of thing, right? One of the seven angels who had the seven bowls full of the seven last plagues came to me and said to me, "Come, I will show you the bride, the wife of the Lamb." And he carried me away in the spirit to a great and high mountain, and he showed me the holy city, Jerusalem, that is the new Jerusalem, descending out of heaven from God. So it's from God. Having the glory of God. That is somehow that God's glory is in this city. Her light, like a most precious jewel, like a jasper, clear crystal. It's radiant. It's just, it just lights up the whole new world, the new heavens. Verse 12. And it had a great high wall with 12 gates, and the 12 gates, 12 angels, and on the gates the names of the 12 tribes of the sons of Israel were written. So this perfectly cubic city is going to be surrounded by a wall that's insurmountable, but doesn't come anywhere close to obscuring our vision of the city from the mountain. Verse 13, 3 gates on the east, 3 gates on the north, 3 gates on the south, 3 gates on the west, 12 gates. Up until now, the city of Jerusalem, as far as official gates, has had a high of 8, and then later a high of 9 when they built an outer wall. So now that there's gates pointing every which way, and they don't have 3, 3, 3, and 3, but this will be symmetrical in the new world. Verse 14, the wall of the city had 12 foundations, and on them were the names of the 12 apostles of the Lamb. I wonder, with you minus Judas, wonder who the new one is. Is it Paul or Matthias? I'm not going to take any bets. We don't know, do we? I'm teasing. Verse 15. He who talked with me had a golden rod to measure the city and its gates and wall. They didn't have tape measures back then. They had reeds or rods. The city lies as a square. Verse 16. Lies as a square, its length as long as its width. He measured the city with the rod, 1,400 miles. Its length and breadth, the height are equal. Length, breadth, and height are equal. Remember, cubic, and there's only one other place in the Bible where something is a cube. And what is that? It's the Holy of Holies in the tabernacle, the dwelling place of God. And I think it's cubic, height, width, and depth is to represent the Trinity, Father, Son, Holy Spirit. Verse 17. He then measured its wall 200 feet by the measure of a man, that is, of an angel. Now, what that means is 144 cubits is what it says in Scripture. By the way, the wall was 12,000 stadia is what it says in the Greek, about 600 feet. We could talk about how that translates into English and how they standardize furlongs, and we're not going to flow with that. Verse 19, that is of an angel. Verse 18, the wall was built with jasper and the city was pure gold. Let's see. I got all excited here. What verse am I on? Oh, yeah, verse 18. The wall was built of jasper and the city of pure gold, pure as glass. And verse 19, the foundations of the wall of the city were garnished with all kinds of precious jewels. The first foundation was jasper, the second sapphire, the third chalcedony, the fourth emerald, the fifth sardonyx, the sixth sardius, the seventh chrysolite, the eighth beryl, the ninth topaz, the tenth chrysoprase, the 11th jacinth, and the 12th amethyst. This is going to be beautiful beyond our belief. We're not going to need a dollar bill or credit card and all that kind of stuff either. Verse 21, the 12 gates were 12 pearls. Now, I can't even get my arm around this one. That's quite an oyster. 12 gates were 12 pearls, and each of the gates made of a single pearl, and the street of the city was pure gold, transparent as glass. Gold that shines so bright. City with a street of gold. Can't conceive. I can't even, it's hard to get up and down our street now. What is it called? Chlorine does a job on blacktop. Next. And the next outline coming at us, there's going to be no temple, no sun, no shutting of gates, and no sin. Ready? Verse 22. I saw no temple or sanctuary in the city, for the Lord God Almighty and the Lamb are its temple. There you have plural, but the way that it's stated sounds singular in the Greek. And that should make you go, right? Because we don't know. Verse 23, the city has no need of sun or moon to shine in it, For the glory of God is its light, and its lamp is the Lamb. The glory of God is its light. It's that somehow God's glory in His presence, that somehow we'll be able to exist in close proximity, and His light will shine throughout the city with no, apparently, little or no shadows. This right here is dramatic. The light of this city, where there is no light, there can be no luster nor pleasure. Heaven is the inheritance of the saints in light. But what is that light? There is no sun or moon shining there. Light is sweet and a pleasant thing it is to behold the sun. What a dismal world this would be if it were not for the light of the sun. You can tell this guy's not an Englishman instead of from San Diego, can't you? What is there in heaven that supplies the want of it? There is no want of the light of the sun, for the glory of God lightens that city. The Lamb is the light thereof. God in Christ will be an everlasting fountain of knowledge and joy to the saints in heaven, and if so, there is no need for sun or moon or any more than we here need to set up candles at noonday when the sun's shining in its full strength. Amen. That was Matthew Henry. Verse 24, and the nations of those, I take this to be Gentiles, the predominantly Gentile followers of Jesus after the ascension into glory, but also including the Jews, it's just those who are Israel, true Israel. And the nations of those who are saved shall walk in its light, and the kings of the earth shall bring their glory and honor into it. Now, what does that mean? I didn't know there'd be any kings and queens in heaven, but I'd probably be just like, you know, we'd probably be able to play rock, paper, scissors with them just like we would our kids. But everybody, kings down to paupers, the ground is level at the foot of the cross. I would not doubt that that we'll be that we will be joyful and together in all socioeconomic strata, all that kind of thing. There won't be any poverty in heaven. There won't be anybody richer than anybody else, I suspect. It's going to be wonderful. Verse 25. Its gates shall never be shut by day, for there shall be no night there. Is the gates open all the time? Back in Jesus' day, that was a no-no. You always shut the gates at night so that no bad guys from either thieves or marauders or robbers or some advanced forces of an enemy army could not come upon you without significant warning. But there in the New Jerusalem, the gates will never be shut. No need to. There'll never be any night. No bad guys around. Verse 26, they shall bring into it the glory and honor of the nations. That is, the goyim, all the nations of the world. And don't think of France and the Philippines and United States flags. Think of all the people groups, the nations, the people groups, the different brands of people. Remember, there's only one human race. There's only different ethnicities. We're all ethnicities. We're all cousins eventually, right? Somebody say amen. We're all cousins. Whether it's 64th cousin or whatever, we're cousins. Even your wife is kissing cousin. You're just a distant one. Pat and I are fourth cousins by marriage. By marriage, we're not blood related. But we were stunned when we were, before we got married or after we got married, I think it was before, I don't remember. But anyway, it didn't slow me down because it wasn't blood. Verse 1 of 22. Let's go ahead and skip on to there. Yeah. Then he showed me a pure river of the water of life, clear as crystal, flowing from the throne of God and of the Lamb. Now, if you go back to Ezekiel chapter 47, I encourage you to do that. You can read about how in the new millennial kingdom, it talks about water flowing out from the temple. Remember Jesus stood at the temple when they poured those two barrels down? It says, I'm the living water, right? And but it starts out ankle deep, knee deep, thigh deep, waist deep, and then you can swim in it, and then it gets so, it's a raging river that's running fast and deep. Ezekiel 47. And it's a beautiful sight. Beautiful sight of what God's glory, how he's going to solve the problems of the world by creating the new world. Verse 2. In the middle of its street, so heaven has this street of gold, right? It sounds like Main Street. In the middle of its street, sounds like the Main Street. But we don't know that for sure. But on each side of the river, so the street, there's a river down the middle of the street, and on the side of the river was the tree of life. It sounds like there's one tree, but it's on both sides of the river, which bore 12 kinds of fruit, yielding its fruit each month. Is it different kind each month, or are they all 12 different kinds of fruit all 12 months? We don't know for sure. The leaves of the tree were for the healing of the nations. The healing of the nations. It is, when we get to heaven, will this be a part of God making all things new for us? Verse 3. There shall be no more curse. No more curse. No more first, second, and third laws of thermodynamics. The throne of God and of the Lamb shall be in it, and his servants shall serve him. And they shall see, verse 4, and they shall see his face, and his name shall be on their foreheads. More on that later, about we shall see his face, is the word Ehud is there. We'll talk about that again. Verse 5, night shall be no more. They need no lamp nor the light of the sun, for the Lord will give them light, and they shall reign forever and ever. Are you with me? Is this where we're going? The celestial city, as it said in the Pilgrim's Progress? Next slide. Are these things true for you? They're true. Or are they true for you? Is Jesus your treasure? Because if I don't treasure Jesus now, would I treasure Jesus then? Next. Verse 17 in chapter 22, if you still got your Bible open. There is an invitation given at the end of the Bible. We won't do the whole thing, but verse 17, the Spirit and the bride say, come. Let him who hears say, come. Let him who is thirsty, come. Let him who desires take the water of life freely. And that's my invitation to you. If you have never received Jesus as your Savior, bow your head and take the living water. Receive Jesus. Oh, Heavenly Father, for anyone here who needs you, well, we all need you, Father. But if there is anyone here who has never come to the newness of life that is in you and you alone, oh Lord, may this be the day, may this be the moment. Lord, may we not give ourselves any rest, any peace, Lord, until, and may you not give us any rest or peace until we get this hammered out, Lord, until I find myself on my knees, on my face, calling out to you and say, my Lord and my God, repent of my sins. I want to live for you forever. Lord, we can only do that if your Holy Spirit works on us. Lord, I'm praying like I'm explaining things to you, Father, forgive me. But for all of us here, the Holy Spirit, if you sense the Spirit of God penetrating your heart, your mind, convicting you of sins, telling you he's right. Jesus is King of Kings and Lord of Lords, and one day you're going to have to stand before him and give account of all the deeds you do in your body, how you've treated him with shame and contempt and irrelevance. Make peace with him this day. He says, come to me, all you who are laboring, weary and labor and hidden. Heavily burdened, come to me and find your rest. I am your rest. Rest in Jesus. Oh, Father, make it so. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Those who are going to join us in distributing the elements for Lord's Supper, please come forward.
You're the Lamb who bears our sins away, slain for us. And we remember made that all who come in faith find forgiveness at the cross. So we share in this bread of life. Savior Jesus Christ, torn for you. Eat and remember the wounds that heal, the death that brings us life. Pay the price to make us one. So we share in this bread of life, and we drink of this sacrifice as a sign of our bonds of peace around the table of the King. Around the table of the King.
Mary, help me out here as I explain. Getting on track is recall everyone. Remember, know this. This church, we consider ourselves an open communion. If you belong to Jesus, nobody's going to pull the bread or the juice back and say, are you sure you're a Christian? Aren't you a Methodist? Nobody's going to say anything like that. All right? Is you, Methodist going to be in heaven. Remember that. There's going to be Methodists in heaven. But if you haven't been baptized by immersion, the way Baptist, that's the term is a derisive name. If you're not a Baptist, you still are welcome to celebrate Lord's Supper with us. We don't want to promote brotherhood, sisterhood of Christians, remembering that the Baptist doctrine is we all stand before God and give accountability to Him and Him alone. And so, in other words, it's on you. And I say that in a little bit of jest, but in seriousness, is what I do caution you, is if you're not living at peace with God and man, if you're bearing a grudge, somebody else knows it, especially if somebody else knows it, and even worse would be somebody within this room, and you take of the Lord's elements. The Bible, 1 Corinthians chapter 11, cautions against it, and even talks about some that God has struck dead by doing it. Ladies have come to me, men, a couple of men, but usually it's a lady. I feel guilty about such and such, and I never say yes or no. I tell them, you pray about it, and you do it the way that you sense that God is leading you. In other words, I don't want to lord it over anybody here on coming to the table. But understand for our guests, non-members, which again, you are welcome at the table as long as you know Jesus as your Savior and you're living as best you know, all of us included, at peace with God and man. Come, you're welcome. Now, mechanically, how we're going to do this is we have options this day. Is we're going to distribute, you know, back away so I'm not spitting on it. Is we're going to put, Larry has put the crackers in cups. So you'll get your bread by taking a cup just like you would with the juice. You with me? And then we'll consume that. And then we'll come around again with the juice like we always do. The exception, or the what's different, is in the middle of the bread dishes is those to-go cups. If you would prefer to use a to-go cup rather than the way they're being distributed, you may do so. And nobody give anybody else a hard time how they do it. Amen.
That's right.
All right. Let me pray. Father God, the body of our Lord and Savior Jesus. Oh, Heavenly Father, for those of us that were in John 19 today, what a gory, horrible story. What an experience that our precious Savior went through that we might come to this place at this time and say thank you and proclaim your death and your burial and your resurrection till you come again to get us and go to where we talked about in the sermon, that new Jerusalem. Oh, Heavenly Father, until you come, we observe it, and we're grateful. We thank you. In Jesus' name, amen.
On a hill far away stood an old rugged cross, the emblem of suffering and shame. And I love that old the dearest and best for a world of lost. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown. Despised by the world as a wondrous attraction for me. For the dear Lamb of God left his glory above to bear it to dark Calvary. So I'll cherish the old exchange it someday for a crown. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a
Jesus had given thanks. He broke the bread and he said, "Take, eat. This is my body which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Father, for the blood of Jesus, the life-giving blood. Lord, you tell us in the Old Testament the life is in the blood. And Jesus poured out his own blood that we might be one in Christ and with him. One in Christ, one together with you. Oh Lord, we don't really know what all that means, but Lord, we know that it's glorious beyond our imaginations and we can't wait. So Father, receive the element, receive our worship, Father, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. My life, my love, I give to thee, the Lamb of God who died for me. Oh, may I ever faithful be, my Savior and my God. I'll live for him who died for me. Happy then my life shall be. I'll live for him who died for me, my Savior and my God. I now believe thou dost receive what thou hast died that I may live. And now henceforth I'll trust in thee, my Savior and my God. I'll live for him who died for me. How happy then my life shall be. I'll live for him who died for me, my Savior and my God. Oh, thou who died on Calvary to save my soul and make me free, I'll consecrate my life to thee, my Savior and my God. I'll live for him who died for me. How happy then my life shall be. I'll live for him who died for me, my Savior and my God. Yes, I'll live for him who died for me. How happy then my life. I'll live for him who died for me, my Savior and my God, my Savior and my God, my Savior and my God.
Same manner Jesus took the cup after he had supped, saying, "This cup is the new covenant given in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." We always remember that it's what Jesus did on his cross. We take up our cross and follow him. As often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. As often as you drink, as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim his death until he comes. And Jesus said, "Occupy till I come." When he says occupy, it doesn't mean just to occupy space. Occupy, like occupation, means to do the Lord's work until he comes back. Give him a good return on his investment. I wish you a blessed week, serving the Lord, walking with him, receiving his love and his grace and his peace and his joy. When you stumble, you repent. Something to remember. Christian, some of this might be worth the price of admission. And that is the difference between Jesus paying for our sins and forgiveness of our sins. If we don't remember that Jesus has already paid for all our sins, past, present, and future, when we sin a sin, if it's worse than what we think it should be, we'll start thinking, "I don't belong to Jesus anymore." But Jesus already paid for that sin. Now you repent. Enter back, get back into full fellowship with me. You with me? We don't have to rebaptize a bunch of people. We just keep working out our salvation with fear and trembling. Like it says in the scripture. Would you please stand? Oh, Heavenly Father, your blessing on these precious ones. Lord, keep them in your loving care. Draw them, Father, ever to the cross, ever to your throne of grace, someday in glory. If there's time on the schedule, have a Broadway reunion on the other side. How much better than 1135 North Broadway would it be to have an address in glory with you? Our great God, we love you and we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Brother Steve.
Wherever he leads, I'll go. Wherever he leads, I'll go.